The meeting is called to order at 7 p.m. Governing board meetings are held in the boardroom at the Ben Furlong Education Center located 8700 South Kyrene Road in Tempe. We regularly meet on the second and fourth Tuesdays of the month. However, there is only one board meeting in March, July, and December. All meetings begin at 7 p.m. We welcome community involvement and encourage people to come to board meetings and be involved in our community. School board meetings are held in public to conduct the business of the district. Board meetings will be streamed live on the internet and then posted on the Kyrene YouTube channel, which can be accessed by going to our website at kyrene.org and clicking on the YouTube icon at the bottom left side. Board agendas may be obtained from the district office and the Kyrene website 24 hours in advance of each board meeting. Bless you. Our Superintendent David Schauer, Board Secretary Cindy Miller, senior leadership, lead principals, directors, and interested citizens are here with us tonight. Please stand for our moment of silence, followed by our student superintendent council to lead us in the Pledge of Allegiance.
I pledge allegiance to the flag of the United States of America and to the republic for which it stands, one nation, under God, indivisible, with liberty and justice for all.
Thank you. Will board members please state their names for the record?
Ross Robb.
Michelle Hirsch.
John King.
Bernadette Coggins.
Beth Brazell. Let the record show that all five board members are present this evening. Next is the preview and approval of the agenda. Are there any changes to this evening's agenda, including consent agenda items? Nope. May I have a motion to approve tonight's agenda?
I make a motion to approve tonight's agenda.
Second.
Motion by Mrs. Coggins, second by Mr. Robb. All in favor say aye.
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 Motion passes 5-0. Next is superintendent's briefing. Dr. Schauer.
Thank you, Madam President, members of the board, and welcome to our students and parents who are here tonight. I thought I would begin by mentioning something, and I know that Mrs. Hirsch will mention this in her report later because she has the details on it, but it's called You Make a Difference. And so each one of you has a star at your place, and Mrs. Hirsch is going to explain this later, but I wanted the students from Mrs. Perk's class, who are really responsible for this, to know that we did talk about this at our board meeting, and I have the feeling they might be watching this on YouTube at some point. So we'll say hello to Mrs. Perk's students. So hello out there to you whenever you see this. The other thing I wanted to do was give you an update on the middle school program and the pilots that we're talking about. We presented this the last time to the board on February 26th, and we mentioned at that time that we'd be having community forums, and they are occurring, and they are occurring Thursday, April 11th, this week, from 6:30 to 7:30. And at these forums, each principal will be sharing consistent information for those that are in attendance. And we've talked with them about what should be shared, you know, so that we make sure that we're saying the same thing to both communities. And then we have steering committees that are meeting with district experts, and they're working out the specific details. Many people are asking questions about the 60-minute period, and they want more information about that. And where that work is occurring is with those steering committees. And so there will be an update on that in the future for you and for the community as we know more. And I would think that that would happen fairly soon. So those forums are happening this week. The other thing I wanted to mention was that last night I attended a meeting of the Tempe Union High School District Governing Board. It was a study session, and I was invited because they were talking about the Montessori program, and they are exploring the possibility of offering a Montessori high school program, and they are interested in talking to their partner elementary districts about this. And so Mrs. Christine Bush and I were both there representing our two districts, and they had a pretty interesting presentation and conversation about this. And then the board members who were there provided direction to the committee to continue the work. And, you know, that's kind of what they were looking for, a green light to go forward. So I can give you more specifics on this at another time, but I just wanted to make sure that you know this was being discussed. And another thing that's coming up, speaking of our tri-districts, is April 29th. I think I've mentioned this before, but for the first time, we are bringing all of our principals and district administrators together in Tempe Elementary to talk together about how they can collaborate more effectively. And principals will be meeting in regional teams. And one of the purposes is really just to form relationships with each other so they can start really knowing who each other is and maybe talking about things they could do to support each other's work. And so we think that's going to be really positive. And then we'll be bringing district administrators together as well who have positions in our districts. And they'll be talking about future ways to collaborate and support. And we believe this can lead to many effective partnerships between the three districts. So we're excited about it. The other thing I wanted you to know is there will be a guest speaker that morning named Jamie Vollmer, who is the author of Schools Cannot Do It Alone, a very interesting book that I just received and I'm reading. And then that evening, the Tempe TD3 Tempe Elementary is hosting the East Valley Board Consortium with Jamie Vollmer. So you'll have an opportunity if you attend that consortium to also hear from that speaker. So that should be a nice opportunity for anyone that wants to go. So that's my report tonight, kind of a long one, but I wanted you to have all that information. Thank you.
Next is Around the District with the Governing Board. This is the agenda item where Governing Board members can share observations, reflections, or comments about happenings across the district. Does anyone have anyone they want to share? Mr. Robb.
The last couple of weeks, I've had the pleasure of teaching a junior achievement class at Centennial Middle School about global economics, which is an hour every Wednesday with Mrs. Jake's social studies class. Makes me respect what our teachers and others who interact with our students do every day. I wouldn't want to see what my Marzano score is. It probably isn't very high, but I think the kids are enjoying it, and I am too. So four more weeks of that before I'm off.
Thanks. I have a couple of things to share. First, I want to thank our technology department and specialists for helping arrange for me to visit some of our classrooms with a longtime teacher friend of mine from another district. She was off work and wanted to see what we're doing in Kyrene as far as technology in the classrooms. And we visited a couple of classrooms at Cielo and at Ninos. And that was the first time I got to see the dual language program in action. And that was really amazing. And as Mr. Robb alluded to, it's really something when we get to visit the classrooms and see the teachers and students at work. So I appreciate technology for helping set that up for us and the teachers for indulging us to visit their classrooms. I also visited, I was invited to Monta Vista's Pride in Our Learning celebration and choir concert. And as a parent and a school board member, I've heard a lot of choirs. I have to just offer a huge applause to the choir over at Monta Vista. Those students are so animated and excited about singing. It is truly a fun time. So I invite board members, if you ever get to hear that choir, ever get invited to hear that choir, you should go to that. And along the same lines, at Monta Vista, as Dr. Schauer mentioned, I heard from a couple of students there at Monta Vista in Mrs. Perk's class who are doing a couple of things, and they want to challenge other schools in the district to follow this. They are doing something called Gold Star Mondays, and all of us received a gold star on our keyboard today that says we make a difference. And I was just thinking about this room and how many gold stars I could give out of people that make a difference in our lives. And every Monday, students are given two gold stars, one to give out and one want to keep as a reminder of the person that makes a difference in their lives. So think about that on Mondays, if you could do that at your schools, give out the gold stars. And they are also doing 100 random acts of kindness. And we've all heard about that. This is something as simple as helping somebody with their backpack or opening a door, or it can be something very simple. But they want to challenge other students and staff in schools to take up this 100 random acts of kindness and make the world a better place right here in Kyrene. So pass it on, and I'm sharing with you to challenge the other schools. And thanks for the students for starting that. Thanks.
Thank you. Anybody else? Ms. Coggins?
On what was the date? We attended last week, Beth, myself, Dr. Schauer, Dr. Knight. We attended the State of the District with Congresswoman Kyrsten Sinema, and it was a really great meeting. I think I really appreciated her optimism and her she was very motivated to try to get past some of the gridlock and really bringing both parties together and really trying to move in a direction that I think that everyone in the country is really looking to move. And I was very impressed. And it was very interesting just to kind of hear what's going on and some of the things you think are going on are, and some things that you don't think are going on are not. So I think it was a very interesting meeting, and Beth may want to elaborate on that.
I'll let you. I went to a lot of them, so I know it will take a lot of time. I went to the City of Tempe Courage Awards with Dr. Schauer and Mrs. No, is she here too? And Mrs. Mackey, she's not here. I'm Jamin Mackey. And I wanted to congratulate Terrence Shirley from Kyrene Middle School, who won the award for Courage to Overcome a Health Condition. It was a very motivating evening, and I congratulate to all the students that were nominated. Also attended the Tempe Diablos Excellence in Education Award. And again, I wanted to congratulate all of our educators and principals that were nominated and those that won, because again, that was a very big honor, and they did such a great job, and everyone that was nominated and definitely deserves the honor that they received. Went to the art show that we had here last Wednesday, and it was very well attended with a lot of families and parents, and it's just so great to see the art that our kids can put out, and it's nice to know we have a district that still really values the arts, not just the arts that we had that night, painting and sculptures, but all the arts, the music and orchestra. And it's nice that even within, when we've gone through such budget cuts, that we've still put such an emphasis on really valuing a whole student and really valuing our art program. So I appreciated that. I went to Patriotic Day at Alcamall last Friday, and Kyrsten Sinema was a guest speaker. Ken Bennett was there, Secretary Ken Bennett, and then the guest speaker was Major U.S. Air Force retired Eddie B. Hall. And I was very impressed. Alcamall did a great job, and the students were wonderful, very well behaved. The sixth and seventh grade, they were very, very quiet and very well respectful of all the people that were speaking. And it was a great honor to pay respects to our veterans, both current and those that have served and those are serving now. And then finally, this past Saturday, and I was there, and so was Mrs. Coggins. I wanted to thank the Tempe Diablos for donating some tickets to the Casino Capers, since I was able to attend that. And they do so much for our community. And so again, you know, they're the ones that sponsored the Education and Excellence Awards. And they had a live auction, and I was able to bid and win a car for my son. So I was really happy about that. And it was just a fun couple of weeks attending a lot of different events. And this coming week, Mr. King and Dr. Schauer and I will be going to San Diego for the NSBA conference. So next time, one of us can tell you all about that. Next is procedures to speak to the governing board. Members of the audience may address any item not on the agenda. Please fill out the blue form found on the table near the entrance and submit to the board secretary prior to the beginning of the meeting. Speakers will be limited to 3 minutes each. State statute prohibits the governing board from discussing an item that is not on the agenda, but they do listen and request that staff follow up on any concerns. Guidelines for speaking are posted in the boardroom and on the televisions. Do we have any blue cards this evening? No? All right, then we'll start with our presentations. Dr. Schauer, the superintendent, Advisory Council informational system session. Dr. Schauer. Thank you,
Madam President, members of the board. I would like to welcome the students of the Student Superintendent Advisory Council. And these are students that have been selected by their schools to work with us all year long. And so we meet once a month, and they're going to tell you all about it. But first of all, I wanted to thank them for being here tonight, because this is a late night for them, and they have school tomorrow morning. So I told them they can leave right after this, but I think they probably just really would love to hang around till 9 or 10 o'clock, but we'll give them a break. But thanks also to the parents for taking the time to be here and bringing them tonight. We really appreciate that as well. So first, I'd like to just have the whole group that's here tonight stand, and let's give them a round of applause for being here. Students. And then we have a few students who are going to come forward and actually do a short presentation for you about the group. So you can sit down, but then the ones that are coming up can come up and introduce yourselves and carry on.
My name is Emily Juarez. I am from 8th grade and from Apprende Middle School.
My name is Shreya Patty. I'm in 5th grade at Kyrene Del Cielo.
My name is Alex Manning, and I'm in 7th grade at Pueblo.
I am Jacob Flores, and I am in 5th grade, and I attend Kyrene de la Mirada.
We are the Student Superintendent Advisory Council, and we are presenting the informal presentation of the Student Superintendent Advisory Council. Our Student Superintendent Advisory Council vision is the main idea is representatives from each school take ideas to the district and try to make changes that is reasonable for our students. To sum up, our Student Superintendent Advisory Council mission is it basically says that the main point of SSAC, which is short for Student Superintendent Advisory Council, is to share all Kyrene student voices to the district, to talk it over to the district office, to get their ideas out, to make great changes that will hopefully last for a long time.
Why do we do this? We do this because it's a unique learning opportunity for us students, and we directly experience the services provided by the Kyrene School District. It is also a district-wide support system for students. And we also learn lifelong leadership skills here in the council. So right now, the SSAC Council is represented by one student from every elementary school and two students from every middle school. We are in either 5th, 6th, 7th, or 8th grade. We all have diverse backgrounds, different levels of school success, and diverse interests.
Our status report has been shown on the screen, and we have topics such as grouping students according by their academic levels, more time for specials, better school lunch choices and supplies that can be updated. Our simulations, such as the mock board meetings, the vote that we have for our topics to see if we like it or not, and our real work, and these are real work experiences. What could have been improved on is our student selection. Or you could write a paragraph why you could be on this council, or you can be chose by a drawing. And our impact on our schools could be on better, because it's just that the superintendent only reports back to your class, not the student council, because the student council can actually do something, not because they think that we just sit around and do nothing.
So one of the big things we do in the council is the Gallup student poll. It's a poll that every student takes at the beginning of the year, and it's about a lot of things, your school, your home, and just all about your life. So we've been taking the Gallup poll for several years, and here are the results on the board. So last year, 56% of the students were hopeful about school, 31% were stuck, and 13% were discouraged. 68% of the students were engaged in school, 22% were not engaged, and 10% were actively disengaged. And for well-being, that's how you are at home. 72% were thriving, 27% were struggling, and 1% was suffering. And so the average for all of the students in the district was 82% were hopeful. 87% of the students were engaged, and 75%, wait, no, I'm sorry, I can't see that. Yeah, 75% were thriving, I think. I can't do that.
Hope means the ideas and energy we have for the future. Engagement means involvement in an enthusiasm for school, and well-being means how we think about and experience our lives.
Again, our selection could have been better on because those principals, they say on the paper that the principal chooses the person who has the best skill in their level. And as far as I see, that I've just chosen from a drawing, and I don't think it's fair to other people who have been running for the SSAC council, and I feel bad for them because they have lost, and I want to make it fair.
The SSAC Student Council would like to improve the impact of this council on schools and student councils because they don't know what we do. And so if we improve the impact, then they would help on the changes and, like, improve the changes even more in their school so it works even better for the students.
For a consistent student group, I think that we should try to encourage students to be very excited about Student Superintendent Advisory Council because not a lot of people know about it, so we can try to encourage people. And I have been here for 3 years, and throughout the 3 years that I've been here, it's been pretty cool and awesome to see the ideas that we have changed throughout the district. Thank you.
Thank you. You all did a wonderful job, and thank you all for doing and giving your time and coming out here tonight, as well as the parents, and for doing it on Wednesdays and being part of the Student Superintendent Council. I expect to see all you guys up here one of these days and being in our spots rather than sitting down there and doing it for real. I'm sure you'll all do wonderful, too. So thank you so much. Is there any other, Mr. Robb and then Ms. Hirsch? Oh, Mrs. Hirsch?
Thank you, Madam President. Thank you to the parents for bringing the students here tonight, and thank you for sharing with us what you do. I've attended several of your meetings, and I can definitely attest that you do not sit around and do nothing. The way that you work together and have discussions and generate work plans and topics and do research and presentations, you obviously really care about the topics of interest to the students, and you want to make a difference in the schools and the district. So I really applaud you for that. And the collaboration of working together in groups and going back and sharing what you're doing at your school level, that is something that can help your school understand what you're doing. So think of ways to go back to your school and share what you're doing as SSAC. And the leadership skills that you are developing will serve you forever. I agree with Mrs. Brazel. I don't have a single doubt some of you will be in elected positions someday. So thank you for the work you do, and keep it up. Good job.
I just want to thank you again, too, for coming tonight. And, you know, the ideas, the recommendations for changes, actually, in our last meeting, we're going to come forward to the council with some ideas for improvements. And so I think that there's some really great work ahead of us as we continue this program. So thanks again for being here tonight. You guys did a great job. Thank you so much.
Now you guys can go home and go to bed, too. Get your homework done and then go to bed. Next we have Let's Move in the Schools. Dr. Schauer.
Thank you, Madam President. We have a wonderful presentation tonight about this program, and I will just call people forward and they can introduce themselves. So we're excited to present this to you tonight.
All right. Madam President, members of the board, Dr. Schauer, members of the district and our community, my name is Leslie DeRuiter. I teach PE over at Kyrene Middle School. I'm one of the members of the task force. And we're here to kind of update you on the initiative and what we've done this past year. Okay. Which button? There we go. Did I go too far? There we go. All right. Our goal up here is to provide a comprehensive physical activity program, to provide quality physical education as a foundation, and also to develop knowledge, skills, and confidence to be physically active for a lifetime. We have a strategic plan, which we shared last year, has five areas: quality physical education, in-school activity, staff wellness, out-of-school activity, and also a family and community component. Our major focus this year was to develop monthly plans that include relevant activities for each one of these areas. With help of administrators and PE teachers, we've identified anywhere from 1 to 4 people at each site, and we call them our champions. And our champions serve as a liaison that get out the monthly plan. They also encourage each school to have a Let's Move in School Day, which we plan for the third Thursday of every month, because that was the one day that we weren't off, and almost every month this year. Every school was also encouraged to personalize this, so they could take the monthly plan and make it their own, add new ideas to it. So what we're going to do tonight is briefly celebrate our accomplishments for this year for you. All right. The first area up there was quality physical education. And in that area, K-8 physical educators, along with the curriculum and learning department, worked together this year to align our curriculums and also to develop assessments to the standards. So that was our major goal this year in that area. Now I'd like to introduce Deb Stryker, who's going to speak about our in-school activity.
Hi, I'm Deb Stryker, and I teach at 3 of our elementary schools. And basically, our in-school activities are the things that we've been doing. Our large part of our focus is during school hours, and this has been integrating movement through our monthly plan. Each plan includes suggestions on activities to do in the classroom, during recess, and in PE. And some of our schools have been very creative, and they've held events and things to do that they've held before school as well, such as the Paloma Jingle Jog and Monta Vista's Fun Runs. Our school champions distribute the new brain breaks and activity breaks for classroom teachers to do in their classroom. This gives teachers quality activities to do to break up long spans of sitting time, and stimulates the body and brain to increase attention and learning. So that's part of our plan. In our plan, we also have at lunchtime recess activities. Each school has been pretty individualized and have offered various activities, such as the community education's lunchtime intramurals, running clubs, and also jump rope for heart events. Though most jump rope for heart events are usually held during physical education classes. Our family and communities have been included in our plan as well by sending home information and invitations to attend local activity events such as our Family Fitness Run that's held at Pueblo Middle School and Paloma Elementary, and where to sign up for swimming lessons and links to local city events as well. We'd like to show you a sample of an activity calendar that we send out as well. This is something that we send home usually through a monthly newsletter that goes from school to home, and for students and families to complete together. And it gives like one activity or one thing to do each day of the month. So for my kids at my school, I say, if you mark each one off and you do that, you bring that back to me, and at the end of the year, we have like a little celebration after school. So if you bring one of those back, you just send it in to me, and then I invite you later on. So those are some of the things that we do during school, and that's part of our plan, that monthly plan that we send out. And now, here's Deb Spurgeon to talk about our staff portion.
Thank you. I'm pleased to be here, and I'm also pleased to be part of this group, the Let's Move in Schools group. I truly feel that this is a passionate group that is really trying to integrate not only the student wellness and activity, but also for staff in our greater community. Part of the Wellness Champions is that we each in departments, even within the district, have champions that send on these communications from the Let's Move in Schools group so that we can each take these home and even do them with our kids at home, which is great. It provides a lot of activity. We're also trying to correlate this very closely with our WOW program for staff wellness. And so we really believe that if we're modeling this in our homes and in our classrooms as the staff, that our students will come along with us as we're teaching them. So we're excited to be part of this program and bringing it forward to our staff as well. And with that, I'll introduce Gavin Martin, and he's going to talk with you about the out-of-school activities.
Hi, I'm Gavin Martin. I'm Program Manager and for Community Education and Outreach Services and the District Athletic Director. This year, Community Education has supported the Let's Move in School initiative through Kids Club, Youth Enrichment, and Athletics. Kids Club, each day, all of our 15 sites provide active centers for the students to participate in. We also provide staff-led active games that work the large muscle groups each day and active themed enrichment clubs each week. Along with the physical aspect, we have gone away from the simple, unhealthy snacks to offering fruits and veggies on a daily basis. Youth Enrichment has supported the Let's Move in School initiative by offering a lunchtime sports program, which started at Cielo 3 years ago. The program is designed for staff to plan, prep, and coordinate playground games with each grade level during lunchtime. This year, we have been able to partner with three more schools for a total of four schools. Youth Enrichment has partnerships with 10 vendors that offer physical-based classes. Some of these classes include tennis, dance, basketball, tumbling, karate, cheer, soccer, and running. This school year alone, we have had over 7,200 registrations in these classes. Elementary Intramurals is a new program we started this year for our fourth and fifth grade students. We had three seasons that included kickball, ultimate frisbee, and capture the flag. Each season, the athletes met for an hour twice a week for 6 weeks and then participated in a culminating tournament on a Saturday. 16 of our elementary schools participated with more than 700 registrations. The Kyrene Foundation also was able to donate $4,800 to help 109 students participate in this program. Along with the elementary intramurals, athletics was able to partner with the YMCA, where we had over 125 students participate in volleyball in the fall and 65 participate in basketball in the winter. Those are the things that community education has been able to help support with the Let's Move in School this year. And next is Tony Santion to talk about family and community health and wellness. Thank you.
I have to remember to click the button. What button am I going to? Okay. All right. Thank you, Gavin. I'll talk about our moving forward and also our closing. We certainly want to continue moving forward with all the activities that we did. I think we are very ambitious this year in what we were able to accomplish. In the future, what we want to do is to look at our strategic plan and identify areas of strengths and weakness. We also want to survey our Let's Move in School champions at each site to see how we can make our Let's Move in Schools Kyrene Day even bigger and better. Okay. And in closing, I would like to. All right. And in closing, I'd like to talk about the CDC has published a review of studies that suggest that physical activity is positively related to academic performance. We know that in multiple studies that increasing activity time during school does not have a negative effect on academic achievement, and that recent brain research shows that exercise stimulates the chemicals needed to grow brain connections. And I'll close with a statement from a quote from John Rattay, who's one of the leading brain researchers in the United States. It says, exercise itself does not make you smarter, but it puts the brain of the learner in an optimal position for them to learn. All right. And before we close, we would like to present a Let's Move in School t-shirt to our newest board member, Mr. King. And this is Priscilla Ayoska, our PE specialist at, Estrella, Sierra, and Casa Vida. We thank you for your time, and if you have any questions, we'd be happy to answer them at this time.
Well, I'd like to thank you for the shirt. I'll wear it when I go to the gym. Very funny.
And by the way, our current board members received a t-shirt last year during our presentation.
Mrs. Hirsch?
I do. I think I need to move a little bit more to fit in my t-shirt, but that I got last year. Did Ms. Stryker say that there at one of the schools there's a jog and jiggle in the morning? Jiggle and jog.
Yeah, in the month of December for our Let's Move in School Day, I held a jingle jog day.
Oh, jingle.
Jingle jog day. Yes, it was, and it was to invite students and family to come and join us on the playground, which now we can't do. We'd have to find another alternative, but because it's hard to invite all those families and parents onto the school grounds so early, we'd have to find maybe another way to do it. But anyway, it was really fun, and everybody was supposed to wear their jingle bells on their shoes or, you know, something around their neck while they jogged. And
I was thinking, I'm sure that I jiggle when I jog, so maybe I could do that. But I can jingle as well. So
I jiggle and jog five times a week, Michelle, so we could do it together, I think.
And you're all welcome. If you don't make it to the gym, you're welcome to come join us in PE anytime.
Mr. King?
Yep. A couple of things. The first thing I want to say is, you know, the kids that spoke before you, they were very kind to one another, and they stood in line behind each other. And I noticed you all did the same thing. So I don't know who's leading who in that, but I thought that was kind of interesting. You know, the second thing I'll say is, traditionally, a PE class is where you have PE. This has gone beyond the classroom situation. I like the idea of involving the parents and you know, getting them involved in more of those kinds of things. My son's in track at Centennial, and I'm just so thankful that they're doing stuff like that and this kind of thing as well. Keep it up.
Thank you. Dr. Schauer.
Thank you, Madam President. Tonight, it's my privilege to present some of you with awards, and this is something that happens on an annual basis, and it involves having to earn continuing education credits. And so we have three awards to give tonight. The first one is going to Michelle Hirsch. It's called a Master of Boardmanship. and it's for completing 10 core curriculum area hours. So congratulations to Michelle Hirsch. And then we have two other awards, and both of them are for five core curriculum areas, and these are going to Beth Brazil and Bernadette Coggins. So congratulations. So we really do appreciate all you do, and when you participate in these things, it's nice to have at least some symbol of having done that work. So thank you so much for all you do, because you do make a difference, and you have a yellow star telling you that you do. So thank you.
Thank you, Dr. Schauer.
Okay, I'm really excited to go home with my plaque and my yellow star. Somebody appreciates me.
Okay, next we are going to 7.05 issuance of administrative certified and education support professional contracts for the year 2013-2014 school year. Dr. Schauer.
Thank you, Madam President, members of the board. And tonight, this is a presentation really to make sure that people understand what it is we're thinking. We've had some individual conversations with you about this, and so tonight is an opportunity for the team. Earlier in the study session, we talked about a priority for us is attracting and retaining quality staff members. And so when we think about working conditions and compensation, of course, that's really important to our employees. And we believe that issuing contracts in a timely way, even though we have some flexibility, gives us a head start in the hiring process, because what we have to do is issue contracts and then find out who is actually returning. And the only formal way to really know that is by a deadline that they have to return that contract, and then we know what vacancies we have. You know, so we'll be asking for permission to do that probably at the end of this month at our next meeting. But what we know is that the compensation situation for our staff for the past few years has not been great. And so we had some years of freeze. And then last year, even though we were able to do an increase, the experience for our employees was actually another freeze. Because when the retirement costs went up, the health care for some went up, and then we had a payroll tax holiday that was happening that a lot of people didn't realize was going to expire, that did expire in January. And so when I talked to many of our staff members, they tell me that the increase they thought they had evaporated. And in some cases, it looks more like a decrease. So we think it's important to pay attention to this. And I know that you're supportive of that as well. So now we know there are possible things that can happen with the legislature. So we need flexibility. And we've worked with our legal counsel to have that flexibility in our contracts. And so Dr. Knight can kind of talk about that a little bit, and then if you have any questions, we can certainly answer them. So, Mark.
Okay, thank you, Dr. Schauer. Madam President, members of the governing board, and staff and community. As Jeremy shared with us earlier in the study session, you know, a 2% compensation increase is part of the overall 2013-2014 budget projection strategy. So, I just wanted to add a few comments to what Dr. Schauer shared with you, and then we can have a discussion. But to reiterate what Dr. Schauer said, to optimize governing board flexibility, we have worked with our tri-district legal counsel, Dean Pickett, to draft some language that specifically states what happens if the legislation that Jeremy was referring to earlier falls through. Now, we're hoping that's not going to happen, but we do have some trigger language that gives the board some flexibility to actually, you know, back away from the compensation increase if that was the decision. Over the course of the next 10 days, each employee group will be getting together and discussing compensation and you know, hoping to make recommendations to the governing board on April 23rd how to actually best apply those compensation increases if we go in that direction. As Dr. Schauer also mentioned, the timeline issue of contracts is important because of our retention and recruitment strategies that we have to get moving on. In the issuance of contracts with teachers, at least, there's a limited window when they have to return those contracts. That'd be 15 working days. And with administrative contracts, for certified administrators, those have to be issued by May 15th. So there are some statutory considerations we have to keep in mind. Our goal, as Dr. Schauer mentioned, is to begin issuing certified contracts sometime after our next board meeting, so about the last 7 days of April. First 7 days of May, we'll try to get the education support professional contracts out. And then the second set of 7 days in May, that second week, we'll get the administrative contracts issued. And that should meet all of our timelines. And that puts us in a pretty good position to actually know who's coming back by mid-May. And as Jeremy shared a little bit earlier, that'll help us also with the smart schools decisions. So with that said, I'd like to just open this up to conversation and discussion, and we can talk about how best to move forward.
Right, I have a couple questions or comments, and then I'll see who else does. First is, so are we going to do I'm assuming we're doing what we did last year. We're going to do maybe have them decide, or the different groups decide upon how the breakdown of the 2% is, as opposed to across the board. Are you going to stratify it again, like, or have them decide if they are, or is it going to be straight across this time? Are you going to break it down by amount of years of experience, or have the team decide upon that, or how? What have you thought about that this year?
It's a topic that is very helpful to have in Meet Confer, because each employee group may have some different things that they're focused on. Even though all employee groups last year, for example, had the same amount to deal with, one of the groups, the teachers, decided to apply that 2% in a different way, because mm-hmm. they were hearing from their members that they needed to address the issue of the freeze and how it's affected current employees and new hires. The other two employee groups went in a different direction. So it's just important to have those conversations, because I know that they're collecting information, they're having conversations, and it's just good to have that conversation out in the open. And in each of those meetings, I'll remind them that we have two interests. One is to retain high quality employees and do the best we can to keep them Kyrene employees. We also have an interest, and that is to recruit new employees with competitive salaries. And so we'll just have that conversation and see where they land. And so I suspect we may land in similar places this time around, but we need to have those conversations first.
Okay, and then the last thing I have to say, and then Mr. Schwartz, I'll go to you. The second I wanted to ask you about was, speaking about retention, you had that new paragraph in there on that last page, in the event that someone does not fulfill their obligation, so you have the $1,000, mm-hmm. I mean, you might want to go over that, and then we discuss that too, but I was wondering, do you have numbers of what the what is the amount of people that are like leaving now as opposed mm-hmm. to the past, and have you been tracking that? And
We do track that information, and we're not sure about this year, but we're typically under 10%, which is I think better than what we typically see in the state of Arizona in education. So that's really good news for Kyrene. But I'll track the information, and I'll report back to the governing board what this year looks like. And we should know that, I'm thinking by July. In my timeline, I think usually in July, early August, I'll have the information that I can bring back to you so you can see the turnover for the current year. But it's typically under 10%, which is an improvement over about 7-8 years ago when we were probably 12 or 13%, and we're doing a little better with the teacher experience index, and so we do have veteran teachers here, and they are staying, so that's really good news.
Have you had any pushback on that new provision where if they do leave without being able to find some of that $1,000 penalty? Mm-hmm. What have you heard back on that?
No, thank you, Madam President. My conversations have been basically with the KEA President, Susan, who's over here to my left, you're right. But we talked about this year, I think more than I've ever seen, we've had a situation where quite a few teachers have been asking for a release from their contract, and many for very good reasons. We have had some unfortunate situations where teachers vindicate that they're leaving regardless of whether they're formally released from contract from the governing board. There have been situations in the past, of course, where if it's unprofessional and they just walk off the job, I mean, we have students to think of. But if they just walk off the job, we do have certain recourse in statute where we can actually make a claim against their certificate, and that would be something that the governing board would actually do. But we wanted to build in some language that would discourage anybody from prematurely leaving their contract, because basically they're walking away from students. And so we do have that language in the contract now, but it gives the governing board flexibility that if it's a reason that we feel we want to support, then the governing board could waive that $1,000 penalty or recoup of monies. If it's a situation where if there's an unprofessional act, then the governing board can actually claim that $1,000 back.
And one thing I'd like to point out about that is, you know, that would be a joint conversation, you know, governing board and administration would have, and that's how we do our work. And so, you know, I believe that we would certainly not impose that in a circumstance that wasn't warranted. You know, so there are a lot of circumstances where, you know, you need to go move to be with a sick family member, or your partner has been transferred and you need to go with your family, or, you know, those kinds of things. So we're talking about the circumstances where someone has really acted, you know, unprofessionally, and then we would talk about that and decide what to do.
Okay, thank you. Mrs. Hirsch.
Thanks. I believe I emailed Jeremy about this, and I may have talked to Dr. Schauer about this, but I wanted to get a better understanding of teachers on special assignment that serve in what looks like administrative positions at the school site as administrative leaders at the school. And I thought, if I remember correctly, that Jeremy said that you were looking at maybe recoding their position, or I just want to get an understanding of, do you feel they're getting paid, you know, an adequate amount for the additional? We've all heard how much more work principals are doing and assistant principals, and I don't know whether teachers on special assignment are called student advisors or assistant principal. I'm not sure what their title exactly is, but could you speak to whether you feel that we need to look at that or consider something so that their pay is in line with the extra duties they're doing?
No, that's a great question, Mrs. Hirsch. And the conversation about the compensation part of your question is actually occurring in Certified Meet Confer. And so one of the interests is, you know, should we recognize the workload of that group of teacher on special assignment as being unique? And by the way, we have about 75 or 80 teachers on special assignment, and less than a third of those are actually student advisors. Those are folks who work in schools who have quasi-administrative responsibilities. So that conversation is actually occurring in Meet Confer. And I think there is wide recognition that we need to do something, whether it's lengthen their contract or maybe look at an additional stipend above and beyond their contract to reflect the nature of their duties. They do spend more evenings at the school than teachers. In terms of the coding, I'll turn it over to my colleague, Jeremy.
We've actually got a meeting scheduled internally to sit down with HR, between HR and business services. And what we're going to end up doing is we're going to go through all of our job descriptions that we have for our different positions, especially the ones that are in question, but also we've expanded that a little bit more. We're going to go over those job descriptions. We're going to talk about what are they actually doing on a regular basis. And then those object codes, so in the study session we talked about mm-hmm. some of the object code descriptions. Well, the object code descriptions also have some very detailed descriptions when it comes to job functions. So we're going to look at those descriptions, and we're going to compare funding descriptions to what we're using for our job descriptions. And we're going to look at rewriting some of our job descriptions, as well as making sure that we're moving people into the right categories based on the work that they're doing. So that's how we're going to address the coding part, to make sure that everybody is being coded properly. And then as Dr. Knight pointed out, while we're doing that, if they are doing administrative responsibilities as opposed to responsibilities that would be typically associated with a student advisor or a counselor, then we can talk about should there be any change in compensation. So that'll be a second portion.
And
of
a follow-up question, how this relates to contracts. If you're discussing this in meet and confer or internally, would that happen in time to affect a contract for next year? Or are they looking at having just, you know, you finishing up these discussions and then it doesn't take place for a whole nother year at this time?
No, we're going to have these, there's about four or five issues that are timely right now with certified, and we're going to be actually meeting tomorrow.
Okay.
And if we don't get to it tomorrow, then the subsequent meeting we'll be able to get to it and bring back to the governing board a recommendation as to how to treat this class of employee.
Okay, thanks for clearing that up for me.
And as Mr. Caius was explaining his coding and that kind of thing, I had this image of Russian nesting dolls. I'm not sure which one that is. They'll be forever ingrained in my my head.
Mr. King, do you have
you may need to educate me a little bit on this, but you have a pool of money, some amount of money, that you're going to, so correct me where I'm wrong, King, where you're going to break down by divisions of the organization, and each of those divisions is going to receive a certain amount that they then decide how it gets disseminated between their people. Is that generally the idea?
What we ended up doing last year is we costed out what 2% would look like to increase contracts, all contracts, by 2%, and more importantly, what the impact would be on our maintenance and operations fund. At that point, we went to the three different employee groups and we told them, this is for your employees, this is the amount that 2% equals, and told them, you know, that we're looking at doing a 2% increase. For support and administrative, they said, that's fine, just go ahead and give everybody a straight, flat 2% across the board. Certified had a little bit different opinion on it. And so they wanted to see a tiered structure where those that were here longer got a little bit higher raise than those that were new to the district. And we told them, well, that's fine as long as your total comes up to the same total as if we had just given a 2% raise across the board. So, you know, with that, we worked with them in developing a plan that would accomplish what their goals were, but at the same time met the criteria of equaling a flat 2% increase.
Why don't you do something that's performance-based? PFP, pay for performance.
We have several performance pay funds right now. So classroom site fund is performance based. You know, the governor has a performance pay plan that's out there. That's not to say that we couldn't, you know, career ladder. That's not to say that we couldn't add another new metric for performance based pay. But I think something like that would take a little bit more time to develop than what we're looking at for the window that we're dealing with now for issuance of contracts.
But what's the incentive, I guess?
John, I just want you to know this. You know, with the implementation, and everyone, with the implementation of the Marzano plan and now delineating levels of performance, you know, that are required, eventually that is going to be about performance pay. You know, but the state is moving wisely, you know, at a slow pace with that so that we can implement these things and make sure that we're doing it fairly, so by the time we do start, you know, compensating based on that system, we'll know that we've, you know, we've done all our homework.
And I apologize for my narrow-mindedness on this, but I come from a business world where pay for performance is the only way they do it, and there's an incentive issue there. Obviously, you know, people who work hard should be recognized, who work hard and do good jobs should be recognized for it, and the people who don't should not receive equal recognition for someone who's worked a lot harder than them. That's really where I'm going with this. And so I think what I'm hearing you telling me is that's not even in the vision at this point.
For this particular 2% increase, no, we haven't discussed making this a performance-based 2% increase. But as Dr. Schauer had pointed out, the state is moving in that direction, and not just for teachers. They're moving in that direction for all employees of the district.
Thank you.
Yes.
You know, I always go back to, you know, with this new Marzano, I know that there's a lot of anxiety about how those evaluations are being made and who's giving those evaluations. So, you know, I see where we need to move cautiously going in that direction just based on where we're at with the evaluations. However, I do feel that when you have the certified team
who truly know who the teachers are and the people I would assume that deserve, or if it's based on, you know, a very successful teacher that everybody respects. And it falls in timelines. I think that we, and again, I'm not sure exactly how it all works, but I would assume that that would be a safer way, and it would be a little more complicated than just doing a flat. But I think it would serve the purpose of people that ultimately have maybe, you know, someone just came in and has been here for 2 months versus someone who's been here for 16 years and hasn't been compensated for all of the extra that they've been doing. So, again, that's not my expertise, but I would support us moving in that direction. And then, you know, going back to, you know, a concern that I had about the 2% was, I think that just where we are in general, kind of dangling that carrot that we're going to do a 2%, and then if for whatever reason, you know, I don't think we're going to have a strong, and Jeremy, you probably know this more than I do, but we're not going to maybe even have a budget till July-ish, June, July, from the governor's office. You know, and that I think May sounds like a great ideal, but I've had people say could be, is, you know, if, depending on where all of the other issues lie, I would hate to have to take it away. And so is there a way, and again, I missed earlier where you may have talked about reserves, but is there a way for us to kind of make a commitment somehow and say that we would get into, I mean, again, it's hard to do it without having the whole budget out, and that's.
And that's what we had went over in the study session is, right. Is that basically, you know, at this point, we've already taken program changes off the table. We've taken class size increases off the table, and we wanted to take salary freeze off the table as well. And we were demonstrating earlier how we can still accomplish meeting our target, even if the bond legislation doesn't go through, how we will still balance our budget using some of the other strategies that are on the list.
Okay. So really, we just don't know until we get further down the road. I mean, that's okay. Thank you.
Mr. Robb?
But based on Dr. Schauer's introduction of this agenda item, it's my understanding that the contracts that we are planning on issuing are going to have some kind of conditional language about the bond, yes. Either the bond legislation. Do we know what that language looks like? Has that been developed
yes.
already?
Dean yes. has worked with us, and yeah, you should have a copy of it.
Okay. Great. And that's all been. And I think the language probably says something about that we're not mandated to pull it back, but we
Correct.
Have the option to pull it back.
Correct.
So I think, to Mrs. Coggins' point, we certainly always have the ability to use reserves or, you know, any of the other budget balancing strategies. But I think we all understand why we potentially at least need the flexibility, and I assume that that's been explained over
yes.
and over again.
I had one last thing I wanted to mention too, going along the lines of Mr. King and Ms. Coggins said, that I think it's, you know, a good idea too to have the raise maybe not dependent upon just right across the board, but rather than, I feel more comfortable rather than having the governing board determine how we split that up and whether it's going to be on performance or longevity or something like that. I'm glad that we're having meet confirmed team come up with that, but the teams themselves come up with that, because then they're comfortable with whatever they decide. They're all bought into it. So, like, again, last year, they agreed that teachers that had this many years' experience received this percent. Those that had less got zero, you know, had less percent, and that they all bought into it, and they were all happy with that. And so I'm more comfortable at saying they're going to get this amount of money and then let them figure out the best way to divide that up, as opposed to having us say it needs to be based upon this, this, and this, because their criteria should be based upon what the team feels like is fair, as opposed to what we feel like is fair. At least that's how I see it.
You know, and the thing I would add to that is we have our expertise at the table, you know, with these groups. And so as the discussions occur, you know, we really do work as one team. And it's like, you know, we try to share our wisdom about the fact that, you know, you really do need to invest in both attracting and retaining. You know, it's important. You have to do both. And like we've seen with the freeze, what happens with a freeze is you're not investing in either one. And then when you start giving increases, those that have been frozen that have been here feel like, you know, they'll never get caught up, you know, because you're increasing across the board. So that's why they had that plan last year. And so we, I know Jeremy spends a lot of time with them, and so I just wanted to assure you that our financial experts are working with them as well on the ideas they have to make sure they're good ideas.
And Mrs. Coggins, I appreciate your comments also. I think it buys a lot of goodwill when there's employee voice in these decisions. But the future when Mr. King was talking about, the private sector, that's going to be a piece of the future in the public sector. And so just in 2 years down the road, we have to have a pay-for-performance incentive piece built into the evaluation. So that's already in statute. But the teacher evaluation design team will be working on that. And the good news is that we'll have the employee voice at the table as we develop those plans to make sure that it's fair and equitable, but gets to the intent of the legislation.
For those of us who get no increase ever, any smile or thank you is welcome.
You received a star and a plaque. A plaque and a star, Michelle. All right, any other questions or concerns? Okay. Thank you.
Okay. Thank you.
Next, the consent agenda. May I have a motion to approve tonight's consent agenda?
Just one thing real quick. I will not be voting on item 8.03, which is a KEBT item, and I'm covered under that policy. So please mark me as not voting on 8.03.
So noted.
And I will move approval of the consent agenda with that one corollary.
Okay.
Second.
I have a motion by Mr. Robb, second by Ms. Hirsch. All in favor, say aye.
Aye.
Aye. Motion passes 5-0. Next is our action items, items for consideration, discussion, direction, and possible approval. And we have one thing under that tonight, acceptance of an audit report year end June 30th, 2012.
Madam President, Dr. Schauer, members of the board. So we had our students here tonight. We had our teachers here tonight. We've had awards. And now, without further ado, I bring you our auditor, Jill Shaw, with Heinfield & Meach.
Thank you for having me here tonight to present the audit reports. First of all, I just want to start by thanking Jeremy and Jackie and their entire departments for their help in completing the audits in a timely fashion. And I know they're already hard at work at preparing for the next audit, so it's, you know, kind of a never-ending process. As part of the audit, we actually do three audits in one. I understand that you have these audit reports electronically, but I'll just kind of go over each one and their purpose. The first report is the annual financial report, and that's the financial audit that we do. It is what people think of when they typically think of an audit, you know, the financial statements, and are those properly stated in accordance with GAAP. So things like, you know, is the cash match the cash that's with the county treasurer, that kind of thing. And there's a couple of sections in there that I like to point out for board members. The management's discussion and analysis section, as well as the statistical section in the back, those are two sections that that give people maybe of a non-financial background a couple of quick reads where they can get a good idea of how the district's financial situation improved from the year before and kind of what kind of trends are happening of a financial nature. And particularly the statistical section, that's a section that your bond analysts and other outside agencies will use to kind of get some of those financial trends and the overall financial health of the district. So as far as the financial statements go, we did issue an unqualified audit opinion this year, so also known as a clean audit opinion. So that is the best type of opinion that the district can get. So that was good. The second audit that we do is the federal audit, also known as the single audit. And that is required because the district spends more than $500,000 in federal awards each year. So those are grants like Title I grants, special ed grants, the child nutrition programs for free and reduced lunches. So each year we do a risk-based analysis to determine which federal programs we're going to look at. And this year we looked at the special education cluster and then the education jobs fund, which was a program that was kind of went along with the federal stimulus items. So we looked at those two federal programs specifically this year, and we had no findings or weaknesses associated with that federal portion of the audit. In addition, in accordance with government auditing standards, we're also required to look at internal controls over the financial statements, and we also noted no findings in that area as part of the single audit. And then the last audit that we do is a compliance audit for the USFR, the Uniform System of Financial Records. And this is about a 20-page questionnaire that the Auditor General puts together with over 300, you know, yes-no questions that we're required to incorporate into our audit in order to be able to answer yes or no to those things. So we also do that part of the audit. And any comments that we have are noted in the appendix to that audit. And there were just a couple of things this year. So those are the three different audits that we do. And all audit reports have been submitted to the Auditor General as well as ADE. So that process has already been done this year. But are there any questions that I can answer as far as the audit process or anything about it?
Does anybody have any questions? No, seeing that, may I have a motion to accept the audit report year ended June 30, 2012, as completed by Heinfeld, Meach and Company?
I make a motion.
Second.
Okay, motion by Mrs. Coggins, second by Mr. Robb. All in favor say aye.
Aye.
Aye. Motion passes 5-0. Next.
Thank you.
Thank you.
Next is information items. We have two items on there this evening. After that, we have items for future consideration. Do any board members want to list any additional items? No? Okay, the next meeting will be two weeks from tonight, April 23rd, and will be moderated that evening by Mrs. Coggins, since I will not be in attendance that night. Finally, we have adjournment of the regular board meeting. We have a motion to adjourn this evening's meeting. Okay, moved by Mr. King, second.
Second.
And Mrs. Hirsch, all in favor?
Aye.
Aye. Motion passes 5-0. Meeting's adjourned at 8:10 p.m.